Thank you all for coming today. And the first thing is the kind of the housekeeping duties to remind everyone that this is it's a public event. It will be recorded, and please silence your cell phones. That's the important stuff. My job is done, but I will I'll say a few words. You know, our seminars are, you know, intended to bring forward interesting perspectives and hopefully stimulate some good dialogue on issues related to WMD threat reduction and Fred's new book, The Bomb. There's more to it, but we'll just say The Bomb, which he insisted I remind you can purchase, and he will sign after the discussion. But it focuses on obviously a very consequential threat to all of us, the risk of nuclear war. His book examines how American presidents, generals, defense intellectuals have thought about threatened, broached, in some cases, just barely avoided nuclear war. The book has received unanimously positive reviews from the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the Wall Street Journal. And I note that the Wall Street Journal review, which my wife saved for me when I got home,
I'm sorry, I'm supposed to use this. Thank you. The Wall Street Journal review by Paul Kennedy of Yale ended with, quote, "The Bomb is a work that should make thoughtful readers even more thoughtful, but it is not a book for the faint of heart." And so I think we will see today, presumably, the wisdom of that statement. Sam Nunn and I, as many of you know, wrote a foreign affairs article last fall in which we certainly judged the risk of a nuclear weapon being used, that risk being at the highest point since perhaps the Cuban Missile Crisis, and yet leaders and publics being alarmingly complacent. Tensions with Russia in particular are high, and we have the risk of no arms control regime remaining for the first time in several decades, unless something happens in roughly the next year. With China, there is little prospect of an arms control regime at this stage. We have the North Korean situation, and the prospects of a diplomatic solution not looking highly robust at the moment. We have the situation in the Mideast, in particular with Iran in the Gulf region, with the JCPOA perhaps hanging on by a thread, the risks of nuclear proliferation in the region should that go away. So we had a lot of issues right now to deal with, and much of Fred's book will discusses what would have happened or what could happen now in an actual nuclear exchange between the U.S. And Russia. I don't want to explain his book. He will explain his book. Again, it's obviously a subject that fits completely in our the center of our set of interests, and we look forward to hearing from Fred. So I'm pleased to introduce Fred Kaplan. He's national security columnist for Slate magazine, the author of numerous books, including what many consider to be a foundational contribution to understanding Cold War nuclear weapons policy, The Wizards of Armageddon. So please join me in welcoming Fred Kaplan to discuss The Bomb.
I will try to speak loudly. Some nice acoustics. This is good. Okay. So I should, just as a counterpoint to the Wall Street Journal review, I should note that the New York Times called it surprisingly entertaining. So you can read it with a smirk and occasionally a laugh as well as your furrowed brow. So I hope so. So, you know, I wrote a book many years ago, as Ernie said, about called The Wizards of Armageddon, which came out in 1983. And I figured there would really be no need to write a book about nuclear weapons. And then a few years later, the Cold War ended. And really for the last 30 years or so, most people haven't thought, much less worried about nuclear weapons, nuclear war. We were all on kind of a holiday from history. And then on August 8th, 2017, President Trump comes out of his golf club in New Jersey and says, you know, it's the Fire and Fury speech. And it wasn't just if North Korea launches an attack, we will unleash fire and fury like the world has never seen. But if they develop the capability to attack us, and they keep making threatening noises, if they develop, if they test missiles. And this was something new. This was not even preemptive warfare, it was preventive warfare. And so a lot of people, all of a sudden, for the first time in many years, started worrying about nuclear war. And people who are younger worrying about it for the first time. But they didn't already quite know what to do. They'd forgotten if they ever knew a lot of the concepts, the drills, and so forth. So I figured, well, maybe it's time to take another look at this. Enough, as much time had passed since Hiroshima and the Wizards of Armageddon as between the Wizards of Armageddon and now, which kind of, sometimes I forget how old I am. That's sort of stunning realization. So the Wizards was mainly about the intellectuals who invented the whole concept of nuclear warfare and nuclear deterrence and so forth, and helped translate it into policy. When I started going back into the archives, for example, when I wrote Wizards, there was almost nothing declassified about what President Kennedy thought or said about the subject. I think the tapes, I don't even think that their existence was known at that time. Now, as I went back through the archives, there's a lot of stuff. And for the more recent events, I did a lot of interviews. So I decided to refocus this book. It is about the decision makers. The bomb is sort of the protagonist, you know, this looming force above us all that sets the context for everything. And the subtitle is about the presidents and their advisors who confronted crises. And there are more of these than a lot of people know, in which they contemplated seriously the use of nuclear weapons. And how they avoided this. And one thing that I learned was that until now, every president who had done this really took a very deep dive into the subject. They immersed themselves in the logic and the scenarios and the possible consequences. And their advisors, some of them were quite, you know, made nuclear options look like maybe a rational thing to do. And in every case, the presidents said, no, I'm not going to do this. This is going to lead to catastrophe. And they did their best to scramble out of the rabbit hole and to seek a diplomatic solution to the conflict. Whether this president will do so is a question yet to be answered, although he doesn't have a good track record for digging deep into the logic of subjects. So let us now go back into the history of this, because it turns out that I'm sure many of you have read books about this subject. Most of these books are wrong. They're based on memoirs containing deliberate lies and fabrications and distortions, and not on the most recently available archival material, much less interviews with the people at hand. So I think where the story truly begins was actually at the end of World War II, when Curtis LeMay, who at the time was the commander of the 21st Bomber Command, firebombing Tokyo and other cities in Japan, was asked by General Hap Arnold, the head of the Army Air Forces, when will the war be over? This was in the spring of 1945. The Nazis had recently surrendered, but the Japanese were fighting on. So LeMay took the question to his staff. They analyzed, you know, how many cities were left to firebomb, how long it would take the bombers to get over there and drop incendiary weapons, how much damage that would have done. And Curtis LeMay came up with the answer. He said, the war will be over on September 1st, because that was the date by which every square mile of Japan would have been firebombed. So that was sort of his philosophy of war. Bomb everything. So when he became head of Strategic Air Command, well, you know, in the meantime, of course, on August 6th and August 9th, a much bigger bomb was dropped, two bigger bombs. And he took over those bombs when he became head of Strategic Air Command. But his philosophy was the same, bomb everything. So by 1960, when there was the first SIOP, the Single Integrated Operational Plan, when they coordinated all the planning of all the nuclear weapons into one plan at SAC headquarters in Omaha, which he was in charge of, the plan at the time, the only plan, the Integrated Operational Plan, was that if the Soviet Union invaded Western Europe or tried to occupy West Berlin, even just with conventional weapons, not even using nuclear weapons, and they didn't have very many in 1960, the plan was to unleash the entire U.S. nuclear arsenal at every target in the Soviet Union, the satellite nations of Eastern Europe, and Communist China, even if China had no direct involvement in the war. And it was estimated that this would kill 285 million people. That was the plan. And by the way, it wasn't just General LeMay and his successor, General Thomas Power, who LeMay once described as a sadist. This wasn't just their idea. This was approved by the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and it was consistent with President Eisenhower's philosophy of massive retaliation, which was codified in an NSC document. Eisenhower was not bloodthirsty or sadistic, but his view was that if there was a war with the Soviet Union, it would go nuclear very quickly. And it would be very destructive. And so his view was the way to deter war was to threaten to destroy everything in the Soviet Union. That was the only choice we had. But then something peculiar happened in the early 60s. The Soviets started developing their own arsenal, which could hit the United States. So then this strategy became a little insane, if it wasn't insane already, because if the Soviets invaded Western Europe and we responded by clobbering them, they could clobber us. So this was a strategy of suicide. And so then people started thinking, well, maybe we should develop some conventional defenses. Eisenhower was kind of a cheapskate. He didn't want to spend money on conventional armies, which he thought really wouldn't last very long in a war anyway. Kennedy and McNamara were a little bit more interested, but it's interesting, the generals in particular said it'll be a bad idea to develop conventional weapons, because then the Soviets might not believe that we would use nuclear weapons in a war. And that was the essence of deterrence then. So there was a serious argument made in NSC meetings during the Berlin crisis. McNamara would say, I think we need some conventional defenses. No, that will make things worse. We're relying on the bomb. We have to go with that logic of the strategy. So the other part of it was, though, that some strategists started thinking, maybe we can come up with some ideas of limited nuclear war. And there was this whole string of thought, which some of you are the counterforce theory. The idea that, well, if we have to go nuclear, let's just throw some of our nuclear weapons at their strategic military forces and then tell them, okay, we've degraded your forces. If you retaliate against us, we're going to take the forces we have in reserve and clobber your cities. That would be deterrence. Now, when I wrote Wizards of Armageddon, I reported, based on interviews with people, because none of the documents were available, that in fact, McNamara devised these limited options. He had five different options in the guidance for the PSYOP. Well, it turns out, based on documents that I've read since and for this book, SAC paid no attention to this guidance. The plan remained the same on everything. What they did, they worked in it so the joint staff would put in a provision, like, to the extent feasible, you know, we should do these limited options. Or to the extent that this is consistent with military objectives, we will do these limited options. And of course, the commanders in SAC said, this is not feasible, or this is not consistent with our military objectives. And the plan remained the same. When Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger looked at the PSYOP at the end of the 60s, they were kind of appalled because it was all-out attack. Was all-out attack. Now, let's go back to Kennedy a bit, because some very interesting things happened to Kennedy. First of all, everybody knows about the Cuban Missile Crisis. A lot of what we know is false, but B, there's a misunderstanding about where the Cuban Missile Crisis came from. And where it came from was an earlier crisis in Berlin, which is not that well known. In 1961, Khrushchev told Kennedy, who he thought was kind of a young punk, I'm going to take over West Berlin. He phrased it as going to end World War II. You know, Berlin, a lot of younger people don't know. You know, but Berlin was 100 miles inside East Germany. West Berlin was this enclave of freedom and democracy. If the Soviets grabbed it, there was no way at the time that we could defend this with conventional weapons. So nuclear, that was the response. And so Kennedy starts having meetings, and there weren't tapes yet, but these meetings are very thoroughly documented. George Bundy and other people took very thorough notes. And they came up with this idea, this four-phase plan. If they take over Berlin, the first thing we do, send out a patrol. If that doesn't work, we send out a battalion. If that doesn't work, we start, phase three is, embargoing some of their ships, doing some provocative overflights, passing a UN Security Council resolution condemning this. And then phase four was nuclear. And there were three parts of that. 4A was a demonstration attack. You know, just one bomb just to show that we're serious about this and you should back off. B was using some bombs to blow up their battlefield stuff, destroying some of their conventional forces. And C was all out. It was the bomb everything. That was it. And there were some arguments about this. Kennedy wanted to know, what's the chances that we could keep this to A and B and it's not escalating to C? Paul Nitze, who was Assistant Secretary of Defense at the time, said, well, I think we really ought to go to 4C right away, because if we do 4A or B, the Soviets could get in a first strike on us and we might not be able to respond. I mean, this was the level of discussion. This was very serious. In fact, a couple of people devised a plan. You know, it turned out right before this, you know, Kennedy came into office thinking that there was a missile gap. A lot of people thought there was a missile gap. The Russians were way ahead of us. First photo reconnaissance satellites came in 1960, and it showed, no, they've got nothing. They've got nothing. Air Force intelligence had estimated they had 200 ICBMs. It turned out they had four. And all their bombers, they weren't on runway alert. A lot of them weren't even loaded. The submarines were locked up in their pens. And so some people did a first strike plan. It's a 33-page document, a detailed targeting document. 44 bombers launching, dropping 88 bombs on various targets, wiping out the Soviet strategic force. Well, maybe. It did note that there was a possibility that a few weapons will survive, especially tactical nuclear weapons aimed at Europe. And if they retaliated, a few million people might die, a few million of our people, our side people. And so Kennedy didn't go for this either. And so what he did, he decided to have his Deputy Secretary of Defense, Roswell Gilpatrick, give a speech. He was scheduled to give a speech at the Business Council in someplace in Virginia. And he was going to give a speech letting Khrushchev know that we knew that there was no missile gap. Because Khrushchev had been going along with this. He'd been bluffing. He was saying, like, yeah, we're churning out ICBMs like sausages. And so this speech spelled it out. How many weapons we have, how many weapons they have. Even if the Soviets did a first strike, we would have superiority even after that. And the Soviets were disturbed by this, as a result of which Khrushchev really did think that we were planning to launch a first strike, which indeed we were. There was a reason for this. Yeah. And so what did he do? He put medium-range missiles in Cuba as a transition before his ICBM program got off the ground. And that's where we ended up with the Cuban Missile Crisis. Now, it is now well known, because it was revealed 20 years after the fact, that this crisis was not settled by, you know, staring eyeball to eyeball with the Russians and they blinked, nor was it the case that, you know, Khrushchev on the last Friday night proposed that he would pull out the missiles if we promised to invade Cuba, and we promised never to invade Cuba. And then Saturday morning he said, no, actually, we'll take out our missiles of Cuba if you take out your missiles from Turkey. The myth for many years was Kennedy ignored the Saturday offer and took the Friday offer. It's not true at all. He took the Saturday offer. But what is still not generally known, and it kind of, I'm not quite sure why, because the tapes of these sessions have been out now for 20 years. The thing that is generally not known is that everybody around that table, not just the Joint Chiefs, but all the civilians, Bobby Kennedy, Robert McNamara, McGeorge Bundy, they all bitterly opposed the trade that Khrushchev put on the table. It would destroy NATO, it would alienate the Turks, we would lose all of our credibility. Kennedy was the only one at that table who said, and this is a direct quote from, he goes, well, this is a pretty fair trade. Any man at the UN would think this was a fair trade. Everybody goes nuts. No, this is a horrible thing. And then, this was on a Saturday. On Monday, the air attacks were to begin. The plan was to do 500 conventional air sorties a day against the missiles, followed by an invasion 4 days later. All this was set to go. And Kennedy says, well, you know, looking ahead, I'm looking at 500 sorties a day, followed by an invasion. The Russians will probably grab Berlin and who knows what else. The blood will begin to flow. And if it's understood that this proposal was on the table, this isn't going to be a good war. Well, the meeting ends, and of course, as we now know, he secretly told Bobby Kennedy to go tell the Soviet ambassador, we take the deal, but if you tell anybody about this, it's off. He also took six people into the next room, to the Oval Office, and told them he was sending Bobby to take this deal. And he said, but don't tell anybody, ever. And because, you know, this was the Cold War. He didn't want to... Eisenhower, he called Eisenhower to tell him that the crisis is over. And Eisenhower, this is on tape, Eisenhower asks him, well, was there any kind of backroom deal on this? And he goes, oh, no, General, not at all. He lied to Eisenhower about this, okay? He put out this myth that he took the Friday deal and ignored the Saturday deal, which led to a lot of revisionist history about Kennedy painting him as this macho war hawk, which he was not. He was very into overthrowing third world leaders who were communists or for whatever reason, but he was not a hawk on this. Now, this is the interesting thing. We now know, much later, that some of those missiles on the island of Cuba were loaded with nuclear warheads. They might have launched some on warning. We also know that the Soviets had secretly deployed 42,000 troops on the island of Cuba, some of them armed with tactical nuclear weapons, in case of an American invasion. So, if anybody else around that table had been president, or if Kennedy had been convinced by his advisors that, yeah, this proposal is not a good deal, let's go ahead with the plan, there definitely would have been war with the Soviet Union, whether either side liked it or not. That's just what was happening. So one lesson of this, of course, is it's important who you elect as president. So then what happens, and this is where things get even more interesting, there is a meeting. And this is also on tape, a couple months after. McNamara, Kennedy, and General Maxwell Taylor, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, are talking about next year's defense budget. And Kennedy says, you know, I don't know why we're spending so much money on nuclear weapons. It seems to me that 40 missiles, getting into 40 Soviet cities, that's enough to deter them. I mean, those 24 missiles in Cuba, I would have been deterred by that. But then as the conversation went on, he said, but then again, I guess if deterrence fails, I guess I wouldn't want to destroy their cities. I'd want to go after their missiles. And I guess that will require more than 40 weapons. So right there, Kennedy, who really, you know, he hadn't read Herman Kahn or any of this stuff, he intuited kind of the basic dilemma of nuclear strategy over the years, which is if you just want to deter, it doesn't take much. But if deterrence fails, and who knows under what circumstances it might fail, You want to have some options. You want to have some ways to limit this, some possibility, even if it's extremely unlikely, to end this thing before all hell breaks loose. But he didn't like that idea either, because he knew that that would still kill millions of people. So Kennedy set out to end the Cold War. That, he said, what we've got to do is end the Cold War. And Khrushchev was game. He gave a speech at American University in June of 1963, which is worth going back and reading. It's a beautiful speech. So he calls for the end of the Cold War. Khrushchev orders that this speech be reprinted in all the Soviet newspapers. They took the jammer, they shut down the jammers on signals from Voice of America so the speech could go through. And then they started doing things. There's a limited test ban treaty, setting up the hotline, doing some other things, and then Kennedy gets murdered and Khrushchev a year later gets ousted. And that is really where the arms race begins, because one of the six people that Kennedy took into the room and told him that he was taking this deal was not Vice President Lyndon Johnson, who came away from the crisis believing the cover story, which is that the way you go after enemies was, you know, eyeball to eyeball and make them blink. And with George Bundy, in fact, in his posthumous memoir, expressed deep regret that this myth was allowed to be perpetrated, that he involved himself in doing this, because it led to tragic misperceptions about the way he was talking about Vietnam. I don't really think Kennedy would have escalated highly in Vietnam. But, you know, by the time Kennedy came around, you know, when he came into office, he was very hawkish, believed in the missile gap, told the Joint Chiefs in their first meeting that he plans to ask their advice all the time. And after three crises, Laos, Berlin, and Cuba, he realized these guys really aren't as smart as I thought, and began to develop his own ideas about things. So what happened later is that, well, again, this crazy attack everything nuclear war plan was still in place. There's always been two levels. There's been the political level, where there are a lot of very sophisticated arguments about doctrine and limited options and tit-for-tat warfare and all these kinds of nice, elegant Tom Schelling ideas. And then at the lower level, which is what was really going on at SAC headquarters, was the exact opposite. And none of this was really changed until toward the very end of the Cold War. Late Reagan, early George H.W. Bush, under the purview of all people, Secretary of Defense Dick Cheney, when one of his civilian advisors, a civil servant named Frank Miller, he's known for other reasons now, but he was a big advocate, Frank, of limited nuclear options. He'd read all the doctrinal stuff about restraint and, you know, the five different options of warfare and so forth. And he sat in on a briefing from SAC on the latest variant of the PSYOP, and he sees none of that. He hears none of this. There's nothing about limited options or restraint. And he tells Cheney, whom he had known in another context, he goes, what's going on here? He goes, I don't know. I'm giving you the authority to go to Omaha with your staff and to dig deep. They are to give you everything you ask for. And what he found out was just astonishing. He found a level of overkill beyond anything that anybody had imagined. For example, 700 nuclear weapons, most of them in the megaton range, were aimed at a 50-mile radius around Moscow. There was an air base in the Arctic Circle. It was a recovery base. It was a base where Soviet bombers would land after nuking the United States that couldn't be used for three quarters of the year because it was too cold. 17 nuclear weapons aimed at this air base. There was an anti-ballistic missile site in Moscow, which, as we learned after the Cold War, was completely useless for shooting down ballistic missiles. 69 nuclear warheads aimed at this ABM site. It went on and on and on. There was, and also the thinking behind the redundancy. There, for example, one of the target sets was the Soviet tank army. Okay, so what the PSYOP did was not just to destroy the tanks, but to destroy the factories that made the tanks and other factories that made spare parts for the tanks and the factory that rolled the metal to make the tanks and the mines where the graphite was found. I mean, it was as if you know, I wanted to destroy your ability to cook dinner in your kitchen. And I destroyed not just your kitchen, but specifically your refrigerator, your freezer, your pantry, your dining room table, the grocery store where you buy your food, the farms where that food was grown. And by the way, all the roads and rail lines connecting these things. You don't really need to do all of that, okay? You don't need to do all of that. But they were doing it in every sphere, every sphere. And then here came the real stunner. At one point, George H.W. Bush was negotiating the Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty. And an assistant to Miller named Gil Klinger asked, who now works at Raytheon, asked his contact in Omaha, he goes, listen, would you still be able to perform your mission if the number of weapons were cut to whatever it was? And the guy, who was a very senior person, the Joint Strategic Target Planning staff, and Omaha, said, well, that's not a question that we ask. And he goes, well, what I mean is, no, I understand what you mean, but that we're not really authorized to ask that question. What we do here is we take the number of weapons that we're given and we assign them to the targets on our target list. In other words, in the operational level, remember Alan Entobin, who was one of McNamara's assistants, wrote a book called How Much is Enough? Well, nobody on the operational level was asking this question. Nobody was saying, okay, given what we want to do, whatever it is that we want to do, how many weapons do we really need to do this? No, it was, okay, we've got, there was a SAC commander named General Jack Chain, who in an open congressional hearing said, I need 10,000 weapons because I have 10,000 targets. And some people thought that he was joking or maybe he's an idiot, you know. But no, this is exactly how the planning was done. And so, according to the Frank Miller and Gil Klinger and their staff whittled this down. At the time, we had 12,000 strategic nuclear weapons. They whittled it down, the requirement for them, to 5,888. And this number is known because Gil Klinger wanted to get a driver's a license plate on with 5888 on it. He decided not to do that. But then, when the Soviet Union imploded, we no longer needed to attack any targets in Eastern Europe. So it came down to 3,000. And basically, the significance of this is that when these arms control treaties, the ones that really started to reduce things, started coming down the road, the military was no longer a resistant force. They had been through this exercise. They understood that, okay, yeah, we don't need more than 3,000. And then it came down even more. Under the Obama administration, there was another PSYOP review, just as detailed as what Frank Miller had done. There were meetings with the Strategic Command commander every 2 weeks that went on for months, examining every single target and how many weapons were aimed at it. But there was something very interesting. Bob Keller, who was the Strategic Command commander at the time, he said at the beginning of this exercise, I think what we really need to look at is what happens if deterrence fails. Because what had been going on in the previous decades is, remember again, the dilemma that Kennedy unfolded. If all you want is deterrence, it really doesn't take much. When Robert McNamara was Secretary of Defense and made up this nonsense called assured destruction, which was they attack us, we attack their cities, actually only about 200 weapons were aimed at Soviet urban industrial targets. In his top secret memos to Kennedy and Johnson, in laying out assured destruction, which somebody then parodied as mutual assured destruction so they could get mad, he said, this is not really the way that the weapons would be used if it came to that. The whole idea of assured destruction was to put a limit on the Air Force's rapacious appetite for more and more weapons. Like, okay, you could draw a curve. Once you're beyond, was the equivalent of 400 megatons, you run out of big cities to hit. And so that's as many as you get. The Air Force was irritated because they knew that McNamara knew that this was not actually how the weapons would be used. It was a bureaucratic device. And by the way, they rebelled against that by developing the MIRV, the Multiple Independently Targetable Reentry Vehicle. They had a limit on how many missiles they could build. And so they said, well, they didn't like the MIRV because it meant smaller warheads. But they said, well, we can get more weapons than what McNamara is allowing us. And McNamara allowed this. One of my most satisfying experiences was when I interviewed Robert McNamara for the Wizards of Armageddon. At one point he said, for example, I never would have approved something like the MIRV. And I happen to have with me the document that he signed in October of 1964 approving R&D of the MIRV. And I reached into my, and I gave it to him. And he read it and he goes, well, I didn't understand the implications of this. And whatever you might think about Robert McNamara, it's ridiculous to think that he didn't understand the implications. He knew exactly what he was doing. So back to Obama. They, this review concluded that, yeah, we could reduce the arsenal that we have now by another one third without any damage to our security. But they said to President Obama personally, we will not endorse this idea unless the Russians agree to cut their weapons by a similar amount. And then soon after that, you know, the Russians annex Crimea and invade Eastern Ukraine, and that was just going to go off. But about, I mean, by the Strategic Command commanders and the Joint Chiefs' concession, right now we have at least one third more nukes than we need by even a conservative. They didn't change the policy. They were going by the policy that George W. Bush had articulated, the guidance about the purpose of nuclear weapons. We could do that with one third. And even somebody who was involved in this strategic review told me we could go down further. Even with a one third reduction, we're making a lot of rubble bounce more than one or two times. So there's just a lot of this. So that brings us to Donald Trump. On the one hand, one development under Trump, there's nothing new about it. You know, Mattis put out the Nuclear Posture Review in 2017, which said a lot of alarming things about the integration of conventional and of nuclear and non-nuclear weapons, the development of new weapons, the fact that nuclear weapons can deter a wide range of threats. This had been going on in the subterranean level for a long, long time. What was different was that this came out about the same time as Trump's Fire and Fury. And even a month before Fire and Fury, you've all read in other books about this famous meeting that Trump had in the tank, the Joint Chiefs of Staff conference room in the Pentagon. This is the one that's been written about recently where he starts yelling at the generals that they're babies and losers and so forth. Well, something else happened at this meeting. At one point, he was shown a chart of number of nuclear weapons over time. And it showed that, you know, the peak year, 1969, the United States had 32,000 nuclear weapons. This included a lot of tactical nuclear weapons. And then it comes to, now we have less than, you know, fewer than one-tenth that number. This was to show, you know, the importance of arms control agreements, the fact that we're in some ways, we're in a much more stable world than we used to be. That's not how Trump read it. He pointed to the peak number and he goes, how come I can't have as many nuclear weapons as we had back then? And it was explained to him, well, you know, we don't really need them anymore. They don't have anything like this. If we start building a lot more weapons, people will think that we're developing a first strike capability, and so then they'll build more weapons. And he seemed to understand this. 2 weeks later, he's in a meeting in the White House with H.R. McMaster, his national security advisor, a couple of other people. He remembers this chart again. He goes, why can't I have as many nuclear weapons as other presidents have? So that's really, you know, it's just why he loves a military parade. It's about show. It's about bombast. It's not about national security needs or any sense of a requirement. It's all, and then 2 weeks later, he brings up this chart again. Now, this might not mean anything except for the fact that we're now about to enter a world where we will not be constrained by any arms control agreements. I mean, arms control agreements have had their problems over the years. They've been used as devices for the military to get more weapons than they otherwise would have. Even beginning with SALT I, the chiefs have said, well, we'll endorse this treaty as long as you give us money for, and then just about any weapon that's been developed since the 1970s is on this list. Jimmy Carter had to approve the MX missile, which he loathed to get salt too. President Obama had to agree to, well, it's been distorted, as he put it in a letter, to modernize or replace all three legs of the triad before the chiefs would, before the Republican Senate would ratify the New START treaty. But still, it's a confining thing, and you also get a lot of verification provisions to see what the other side is really doing. The New START treaty is about to, it'll expire in a year. President Trump has expressed no interest in renewing it, nor is he likely to, because he doesn't like anything that President Obama did. Really, the only reason why he got out of the Iran nuclear deal, which his own Secretary of Defense had said was the most airtight, is a treaty with the most airtight verification procedures that he had ever read, was because Obama had done it. That's all. That's really, I think, the only reason. There's no rationale for this otherwise. So we're about to enter a world with no New START treaty. The INF treaty, which he pulled out of because the Russians were violating it a bit. I mean, the Russians have never liked that treaty. They hated it from the moment that Gorbachev signed it. They approached Rumsfeld a few times to say, let's get out of this treaty, and he didn't want to do it. We're now testing medium-range missiles that would have been outlawed by that treaty. I asked a couple of people in the Pentagon, what's the strategic rationale for this weapon? And they said, well, I mean, honestly, we don't really know yet. We haven't really talked to any allies about basing it. We haven't discussed targeting. We're doing it because we can do it. That's it. So we might exceed the New START limits because pretty soon we can. And so why not? Why not? So the way that I wrap this whole thing up is that, as I said, every president in the past who has gone down this rabbit hole has scrambled out of it. We don't know what President Trump would do if he goes down this rabbit hole. There was a very interesting hearing in 2017, which wasn't covered much at the time and has now been forgotten, although it was an open hearing. It only lasted a few hours, about presidential launch authority. One day, Senator Bob Corker, the head of the Foreign Relations Committee at the time, suddenly learned that the president has legal and actual power to launch nuclear weapons just on his own authority. It's kind of amazing that someone in that position really didn't know that before, but it was true. And this was at a time when Corker was talking about the White House as a daycare center, for an adult daycare center, and President Trump's rhetoric is leading us on a path to World War III. So he held a hearing. And this was kind of confirmed. And it's interesting, one Democratic senator said, look, let's cut the pretense here. The reason why we're holding this hearing is that we have a president who is reckless and who has poor judgment, and we're concerned that he might launch a nuclear strike that's not necessary. Not a single, you can look at the transcript of this hearing, it was an open hearing. Not a single Republican, you know, raised objections to this premise. But one of the people testifying was this retired general that I mentioned earlier, Bob Keller, and he told them, he was very upset about this hearing because he had told them, look, if you guys want to change the rules, somebody had put up a bill to, you know, for a first strike, the president has to consult with his cabinet or with some members of Congress. So if you want to change that, that's fine. But what he objected to was raising public doubts about the reliability and legitimacy of the chain of command and then doing nothing about it. You know, when the founding fathers wrote the Constitution, you know, they thought, well, one day there might be a tyrannically inclined president. And so they created checks and balances and an impeachment provision and other things. It's kind of odd, but nobody has created any checks and balances about a president's, one person's, ability to just blow up the world on a whim. So I wrote this book because, as I said, other presidents have gone down this rabbit hole. explore the logic and come back out of it. This president, whatever else you may think of him, doesn't seem the kind of person to go examining logical sequences. You know, when Ronald Reagan and Gorbachev met in Reykjavik, the note taker's notes are available. They talked about nuclear strategy and nuclear weapons for 10 hours. I mean, we all didn't think much of Reagan at the time, but he actually was briefed very carefully on this stuff. He had some weird ideas, but he understood the implications of the ideas. I can't imagine Trump having a conversation about nuclear strategy for more than 10 minutes. So I figured, since other presidents have avoided war by immersing themselves in the logic, I thought it might be useful for all the rest of us to immerse ourselves in a hidden history of this, where the logic is truly exposed, to see what other presidents have done, and maybe with an eye toward picking some future presidents who can have a more sensitive chain of thinking about this. So thank you very much, and I'm ready to take questions.
Align myself with Paul Kennedy, not for the faint of heart, but some questions. Please say who you are. Sir.
I'm Jeff Smith, Center for Public Integrity, and I've long been an admirer of your journalism. Fred, this sounds like a great book. I haven't read it yet, but I'm going to read it quickly.
Thanks.
Now that I've heard you describe it. I've always been interested in the psychology issues related to building and supporting the production of weapons with this kind of power and consequence to their use. And I had a chance to peer inside. I've noticed that some of the people who become intimately familiar with the war plans recoil, a small minority. But others are comfortable with it and find a way to make themselves feel okay about what they're doing. And I'm specifically thinking of George Lee Butler, who I interviewed at length, and wrote a profile of for the Washington Post, as a very interesting person who recoiled when he became intimately familiar with what the war plan said and what its consequences would be. You've had a chance to talk to more of these guys than I have. What's your conclusion about sort of how people who are still sort of in the game and who will think that this is all good stuff, how they convince themselves about that? I mean, what's your sense of the psychology, and have you seen it change in over different administrations? Because you had a chance to look in the history a little bit. So can you just talk about that a little bit, please?
Well, I mean, it has changed. I mean, there aren't too many adherents of the cult of Curtis LeMay still in strategic commander of the Air Force. Nobody, I don't think, who's still in power would think that the proper response to anything would be an all-out attack against everything. But I think what happens is, as you know, Jeff, this whole business of nuclear strategy can be very alluring. I mean, it's almost like chess. You know, here's my bishop, there's his knight. If I move my pawns up, he'll have to move over there, and I get... The difference, of course, is that when you're in the middle of a nuclear war, I assume, you're not looking down on a chessboard. You might not know what the hell is going on. You don't know whether this missile that you just fired actually exploded, whether it destroyed the target. Your command control might be completely disrupted. There might be some satellites shot down in the meantime. The ability to communicate with your own commanders, much less with the guy on the other end, to figure out a way to bring this to a halt is dubious. But you can still get enveloped in the, you know, one Herman Kahn, in his book on thermonuclear war, he said one of his goals was to create a vocabulary in which this subject can be discussed rationally. Now, maybe it's impossible to discuss it rationally, is the point. But once you get into it, one of my professors, William Kaufman, who was special assistant to every Secretary of Defense from the Kennedy administration to the Carter administration, you know, he told me once that for years, decades, he was eating this stuff for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. He was enmeshed in this world. And then when he quit it and he looked at it from a distance, he said, God, this is a crazy world. You know, you could be in the middle of something, and then you've also got, well, what I'm doing is better than just all out nuclear war. So I think there is a tendency for people who are into this to forget the fact that all this is theory that has never been tested at all. There is no empirical basis for any of that. I mean, let me give you one example. One thing that Frank Miller found out when he was doing his PSYOP review, and by that time we did have some limited nuclear options. He asked somebody at Defense Intelligence Agency, take a look at the Soviet air defense radar. How many missiles could be coming at them in the sky before it's not discrete objects on the radar screen, but just one big blob? In other words, how many weapons can we fire before they can't distinguish, even if they wanted to distinguish, the difference between a limited attack and an all-out attack? And the number was 200. And at that time, the smallest limited option that we had was 900, using 900 warheads. And why was that? One reason for that was, and this is, I had to talk to a few people to even believe that this was true, but it was, any option, no matter how limited, no matter what it was, had to involve ICBMs, submarine launch missiles, and bombers or cruise missiles. They all had to be involved, which is nuts. I mean, for one thing, if a bomber is also involved, it's not going to get to the target till hours after the missiles. If the Soviets, if the Russians are even inclined to view this as a limited attack, what are they going to think when another few dozen bombs hits them 8 hours later? I mean, it makes no sense. It's all bureaucratic. Bureaucratic politics, I haven't gone into this and won't now, but there's been a huge Air Force. In the late 50s and early 60s, the Air Force and Navy viewed themselves as much the enemy as they viewed the Soviet Union. I'm not exaggerating at all. So part of it is bureaucratic interest, political interest, and part of it is just getting deep, deep, deep into something that, you know, if you're into something so deeply, how can you tell yourself, this is all really kind of bullshit, really? You know, I'm kind of kidding myself. You've got to take it seriously to keep doing it. So I think that's a large part of it. I mean, if we all became vegetarians, and I'm not a vegetarian, we might look back, how did these people eat meat all of those decades, centuries? But they see it as something real. You've talked with people too who talk about these scenarios as if they're real, and they're just not.
Before the next question, I just want to make one comment on the last comment you made when you were speaking about the presidency and the authority, et cetera. Just to note that actually, where's Carmen? I don't know if it's Kathy. It was last week we published, or this week we published, an op-ed in California. This week, Monday, which basically follows your logic, namely that among all the things that presidents have responsibility for many of them they have very limited responsibility. One place where they have sole responsibility is nuclear weapons, and decision time can be very, very short. You need to have thought about this before, and therefore we should be asking candidates and presidents now, what's your plan on that? It's almost a unique area where you need to have an understanding that there is some reference frame for addressing these issues. So let's come over here.
Rick, board member of the Arms Control Association. The founders of our country assigned war powers to the Article I congressional branch. So my question really has to do with the oddities of our current circumstances, where we do have a nuclear monarch who can commit the use of nuclear weapons without any authorization. But there are some other oddities that are hardly ever mentioned, like the fact that it's incredibly difficult to ratify a nuclear arms control agreement. Right now, it's really unimaginable that the Senate would ratify anything along those lines. But it's also interesting that while the founders created this two-thirds requirement for ratification, there's no two-thirds requirement to get out of a treaty. And clearly, Trump, no matter how much a treaty is valued by the U.S. Congress, can get out of it at his own
well,
whim.
He's not really getting out. In the case of New START, it expires in February 2021. It takes
there are other treaties that don't expire.
Yeah. And the Iran nuclear deal, for precisely this reason, was not a treaty. I forget what euphemism was used to describe what it was.
Executive agreement.
Yeah, it was not. It didn't require two-thirds. It didn't require any ratification from Congress. You know, the danger of this is that it can be pulled out of very easily. So, and all treaties do have a withdrawal clause. You know, you may withdraw at any time if national interests are at stake, with 6 months' notice or whatever it is. So, you know, it's written in that every arm, you know, the ABM treaty, that's how Bush said, okay, I'm article whatever it was to get out of it, and 6 months later they did. Countries, not very many, but countries can leave the non-proliferation treaty for the same reason. So it's built into the structure of this, but it's, yeah, this is obviously nothing that anybody who wrote the Constitution could possibly have imagined, and, well, along with many other things, for example, the existence of political parties, the Industrial Revolution, or any number of other things, that which is one of the fallacies of originalism in constitutional theory.
But that's not Fred, I think, at least to my knowledge, maybe I'm wrong, but in these treaties, when it says, okay, there could be a sovereign withdrawal clause,
yes.
I don't think it says which can be exercised by the president as opposed to by the Congress. So that's all I'm saying. I think
not explicitly. I guess it's an ambiguity that.
Yeah.
But you know, the other thing about Congress, I mean, let's face it, it's like this hearing that I described. Except for a few years after the passage of the War Powers Act in the mid '70s, Congress is not interested in taking the responsibility for anything, starting a war, ending a war. I mean, the whole business with the red line in Syria, and Obama said, okay, I'm going to leave this up to Congress. First, they'd been hammering Obama for not doing anything. Then he said, okay, I'm leaving it up to you. And then they did nothing. And then they still criticized him for doing nothing. So they don't want to do this. And you know, they might moan and wail about the abrogation of authority by the executive branch. They've allowed this to happen. This is nothing unique to Trump either. It has happened through Clinton and both Bushes and Obama, and Congress is fine to let it go, because if things go south, they don't want to have their fingerprints on it.
One analog that we have pointed out is in the sanctions world, when Congress has passed sanctions without allowing the president to exercise the waiver authority. Like Jackson Vanik, it only took 30 years after the compliance to actually remove them.
Yeah, that's true.
Next
too.
Question here. And then we'll, question over there coming next. Okay. Let's hear first and then.
Thank you. I'm a Stanton Fellow at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Thank you so much for your talk as well as for your book, which I really enjoyed. I wonder if you can talk about, in all of your historical research, what you see is the connection, if any, between American foreign policy goals, which are expansive, and nuclear weapons policy. So you told a story about sort of presidential ambivalence. You know, no one wants to fight a nuclear war. If we wanted a minimum deterrent, that's a reasonably simple thing to do. But boy, if we needed to limit damage, the force requirements for that are enormous, and we're better safe than sorry. And then you told a parallel story about, you know, the SAC and the Joint Chiefs and the JSTPS. That says, you know, these people are, you know, for service rivalry reasons, or because flying bombers is fun, or because they're ciphers whose job is to assign weapons to targets, they construct these enormous elaborate war plans. But at the same time, you can also tell a story about how most countries don't do things like extend deterrence to non-contiguous allies. And most countries don't make it their mission in life to prevent any other country, whether it be an ally or an adversary, from acquiring nuclear weapons. And most countries don't decide that, well, we're really invested in making sure that we have a toehold on both ends of the Eurasian landmass to make sure that no other power comes to dominate it. So I wonder if there's a different potential rationale for American presidential decision-making about U.S. nuclear force requirements, and to what extent, if any, you found that surfaced in any of the documents that you went through as you did your research.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's all... I mean, you've put your finger on what's at the heart of this, which is the doctrine of extended deterrence over the Allies. If we didn't have any allies, we wouldn't need very many nuclear weapons. In the early 60s, this is when it first came up, when the Soviets were developing their own arsenal, and so if they invaded Europe and we struck them, they would strike us. People in Europe, Germany, France, they said, you know, would an American president risk New York for Paris, Washington for London? Are you really going to do this? Some people didn't think so, which is why France developed and Britain developed their own independent nuclear arsenals. And in fact, it was the development of the counterforce strategy, like McNamara went to Athens, Greece, and said, ah, we're not really going to attack their cities. We have this whole new strategy which will spare their cities and just attack their missiles. Nobody really quite bought it, but they thought it was kind of interesting, and what is their choice? Obama tried to, he entertained, he had several NSC meetings, you were involved in a couple of them anyway, to determine, should we adopt a no first use strategy? He had come into office with an idea of reducing the role of nuclear weapons in national security policy. This would be a way to do that. We're telling the world, we don't really think these things can be used for anything but the sole purpose is to just respond to a nuclear strike. We don't think this can be used for anything else. And in the end, he did. He believed this till the end, from the beginning till the end. But he did not adopt it as policy for two reasons. One, allies will go nuts. And in fact, before one meeting when this was held, the Pentagon leaked this. And the Japanese, I mean, the foreign minister came over right away and said, please don't do this. Same thing when Reagan and Gorbachev were thinking about eliminating all nuclear weapons at Reykjavik. The most alarmed people were in Germany and Japan, like, oh my God, this is the extended deterrence. This is our nuclear umbrella. Really? You're going to get rid of this? One thing about Trump, I mean, he, you know, has kind of said he regards alliances as protection rackets, and he's not even terribly interested. He doesn't think it's a good idea to have mutual defense treaties. Why should I put my neck on the line? And I guess as a lot of American people would think, really? The plan is to go to maybe use nuclear weapons if South Korea is attacked? I've never even been to South Korea. Why, Poland, really? The Baltics? Why should I put my neck out on this? One person in the Pentagon told me, he said, I think there was maybe a bigger chance of nuclear war with Obama than with Trump. And I said, okay, I'll bite. What do you say? And he said, well, if there's going to be a nuclear war, it'll be because of allies. Trump doesn't care about allies.
All right. That's a question over there. Yep.
Thanks, Ernie. Thank you, Fred. John Wolfstall at Global Zero. I asked this question cognizant that there's a cabinet secretary in the room, so I'm not assigning any such behavior to you, Ernie. There are a couple instances in the last couple of chapters about cabinet secretaries who basically slow roll president, both Secretary Mattis and Secretary Carter, on things related to, it depends on your perspective.
Both ways,
right. I haven't gotten through the whole book, but there's always the apocryphal story of Schlesinger and Nixon, and I wonder in your research whether you've been able to come down.
It happened.
It did.
Definitively.
Definitely. So
and I'll
can
tell you why. The story,
why don't you describe it so that people...
So the story is that during the last days of Nixon, when he's, you know, running, you know, traipsing around the White House drunken, and that the story is that Schlesinger... Secretary of Defense James Schlesinger called the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and said, if you get any strange orders, call me. Now, if that had happened, I mean, he wasn't even in the chain of command for something like this. But the reason why I know that it's true, well, there are a few reasons. First, Schlesinger later denied that this ever happened. Well, I mean, this isn't irrefutable evidence, but he told me that it happened. He's dead now, so you can't check now. But what, but that's what's irrefutable is that, and I have this in a long source note at the back of the book, is that somebody who was an assistant to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff wrote an article in a very obscure publication, I forget which one, you can maybe look it up, where the chairman came to him and said, here, you should look at this. And it was basically correspondence with Schlesinger discussing this very thing. And he quotes from it at great length. And there's no reason for him, he's a respected lawyer, to just make this stuff up. So it definitely happened.
Chuck?
I served as Assistant Secretary of the Navy from 67 to 71, and so that was at the height of the power struggle between the Navy and the Air Force, and Kurt LeMay was very much trying to keep the Navy out of it. One thing that fascinates me is when you think about it, Joe Nye's just come out with a book pointing out that MacArthur wanted to, he pointed out that Truman always said he slept well after dropping those two atomic bombs on Germany, on Japan. But then on the third one, I didn't realize there was a third one back then, why he decided not to drop it. He was into negotiations. I don't know whether that's right.
I don't think that's true. My research shows that there weren't more than two weapons at the time.
Yeah, that's what I
And what's also heard. Interesting is that Truman, once he realized how destructive these were, he, and this is in David Lilienthal's memoirs, he had a meeting with Lilienthal and his top generals where Truman says, you know, these things are not military weapons. We can't think of them in the same way as we think of other kinds of bombs or rifles. These things kill women and children. And as a result, it was because of that that he established civilian control. And, you know, for several years afterwards, if some, you know, Dr. Strangelove, General Jack D. Ripper wanted to launch nuclear weapons, he had to go through the Atomic Energy Commission to get them. They were kept separate. That changed later.
Yeah.
His fallacy of this was he thought that a civilian president would be more sane about this than a bloodthirsty general, when now we have kind of have it the other way around.
Right. Because if you think about it, another thing you pointed out was in the Korean War, as the Chinese were winning it, why MacArthur wanted to drop atom bombs on China cities.
Right.
And maybe as many as 23 different cities is what he has in his book.
Well, and of course Eisenhower...
And Truman wouldn't go along with that.
That's true. But Eisenhower, you know, one thing that he did, he threatened to use nuclear weapons if Russia didn't withdraw support. And he believed, as did Nixon, that that is what ended the Korean War. There's a lot of evidence going in, you know, it could be Stalin died, for example. That might have been one reason why war ended. There's still a lot of ambiguity on that, but Eisenhower believed, and it probably helped reaffirm his idea of massive retaliation, and also Nixon's view of the madman strategy later, that, well, he looked back at Korea as one place where the nuclear threat worked. One thing that shouldn't be overlooked here, even Daniel Ellsberg, in his very good book, The Doomsday Machine, concedes that probably a nuclear threats on two or three occasions probably did prevent a war from happening. The power of the nuclear deterrent shouldn't be dismissed as something that has no validity at all. I mean, the real question is how many times can we depend on it before somebody doesn't believe it, or before the combination of rash leaders, a crisis, and then an accident, like a false warning of a missile attack, which has happened a lot, way more than most people think, leads to, you know, this kind of all-out warfare.
Yeah. Later on, I worked with Admiral Tazewell Shepard. He'd been the naval aide to Kennedy, and he said, naval aide to Kennedy. He said when it was all done, Kennedy said one day at a meeting, no U.S. president should ever use a nuclear weapon as a first strike.
He and McNamara believed that, but they had to be very secretive about it because U.S. policy at the time was, and still is, and never has not been, first use.
Yeah.
But no, McNamara, there are a few people that he drew and told that, listen, I believe and I've told everybody that, but you have to be quiet about this or I'll be impeached.
And then I had...
He said so publicly much later after he was wringing the blood off of his hands from...
I was at a meeting once, too, that where somebody had been in the meeting when the French had asked Ike to come in and help the French, you know, and he had the Joint Chiefs over there, and he started by saying to the chairman, who was Admiral Radford, and had been a flyboy off the carriers in the World War II, what do you think? And he said, Admiral Radford said, we should go in, we should help the French, and we should use nuclear weapons. And he said, I could see Ike's head go back at that. He turned to General Ridgway, and Ridgway said, no, we shouldn't go in. It's all jungle. It's all, you know, shoring up a colonial power. And he said the meeting was over in 15 minutes because Ike turned to Beadle Smith and said, we're not going in. You go to Paris and get the best deal. So you really had three or four situations there where the president did like that. But the military was kind of scary. Okay, fast forward now to last year.
Chuck, we're going to have to move on. Okay.
What's that?
Yeah, but go ahead. Last point.
Yeah. Last year, maybe 18 months ago, I was at a meeting over at the Metropolitan Club, and one of the keynote speakers was the retired chairman of the Joint Chiefs. And it was the subject was on budget process, but somebody got up at the end and said, would the president, do you think, would the military follow the president if he made the decision? And I could tell that the retired Joint Chief man did not appreciate getting that question. But then after thinking about it, he said, well, that's the system.
Well, and he would have nothing to do with it. This does not go through. Here's what happens. The president makes a decision. He's got the guy carrying the briefcase, which, by the way, is not a button, and it's not something you put it. It's a book with some codes in it.
Yeah.
And somehow, and I'm not quite sure why, and I don't even know if I want to know how, the president's identity is authenticated. He calls a one-star at the NMCC, the National Military Command Center, says, launch, you know, option 38. The signal goes to the ICBMs and the submarines and the bomber bases. So your guy, the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, there might be a protocol where he takes part in a consultation, but he has nothing to do. The decision does not go through him. It doesn't go through the commander of STRATCOM. So in terms of somebody following orders, it's a one-star, and it's people down in the holes who are put in those jobs precisely for there's some psychological profile which suggests that they're the kind of people to salute and do what is said.
Yeah. And just to take it one step further, if you're in a Trident submarine and that gets
the
signal,
on.
It's going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, we have one last question. We have a very talented four-month-old ventriloquist who's having Andy Weber ask a question.
Andy Weber, Council on Strategic Risks. I'm interested from your historical perspective over the last 50, 60 years, civilian control of nuclear war planning. Civilian control of nuclear war planning. Where do you think we are today compared with, you know, the Curtis LeMay example, the Frank Miller, Dick Cheney example, and then in recent years, where do you think we are on the degree of civilian control of nuclear war planning?
Well, as I say, up to between George H.W. Bush and Obama, I think it was pretty solid. There was, and it was mutually respected. There wasn't, you know, this was the system. Right now, I mean, honestly, the remaining civilians in the Pentagon, I mean, a lot of them have left, have neither the clout nor, I think, the ability to do this. I mean, when Frank Miller, or the guy from the Pentagon in the Obama administration was a guy named Jim Miller, no relation, they spoke with the authority of the president or the Secretary of Defense. This was, in, and if Stratcom told them to go take a flyer, hell, there would be hell to pay. I don't detect that right now. And I don't see Stratcom being occupied by strategically firm people either. The last Stratcom, General Hyten, who's now the vice chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, I mean, he seems to me, let's say he wavers a lot. When the low-yield nuclear warhead was in planning and he was asked about this, his initial answer was, look, we've got plenty of options. We need a Stratcom. We've got plenty of options. We don't really need more options. Then it was clear that, no, this is now a program. He started saying, oh, we desperately need this weapon. If we don't have this weapon and the Russians launch a low-yield attack, we only have the choice of surrender or suicide, which is just nonsense. And then the other day, he's testifying before Congress, and he's asked about, well, isn't it more likely that we'll use this weapon if we have it? He goes, no, no, look. And he said, the sole purpose of nuclear weapons is to prevent other countries from attacking a nuclear attack on us, which just isn't even true. And he knows it isn't true. And I called around. I said, has there been some strategic review that I haven't heard about? No. No, there hasn't. Everybody's kind of puzzled why he said this. Well, he said it to ward off a line of criticism against this low-yield warhead, that's all. So I don't think we have terribly strategically sophisticated people in any of these positions right now.
Well, with that note, we're going to adjourn to a reception. Fred is eager to sign books. And to carry on more discussion. So let's thank Fred once more.